We were talking about the idea of random walk dimension, and I'd started mentioning that on structures like fractals, the walk dimension could be other than 2. And let me show you with a simple example how this follows. And after that, we'll go back a little bit and talk about the problem of recurrence in Markov chains in general with application to random walks. Okay. Recall that I mentioned that if you say the square of the distance goes like the time to 2 over dw, where either this or that could be a random variable, and we mean a suitable average. Could say for a given time the mean square distance that you cover, or you could look at for a given distance the time it takes, the mean time it takes to cover this distance. Either way, when you have a relation of this kind, a scaling relation, then one says that the random walk dimension of that particular process is dw. And for normal diffusion, it turns out dw is 2 because we know r squared goes like t, it scales like t. Well, the formal expression for this can be found in the following way. Suppose you have two distances, say one of unit distance and one which is double that. Then if the corresponding times are t1 and t2, it's clear that dw then is equal to log t2 over t1. Divided by log 2. So how long does it take to cover twice the distance? So t1 is the time taken to cover some distance, and t2 is the time taken to cover twice the distance. You take the ratio of these two, take the log and divide by log 2, and that gives you tw. So this is what we'd like to do. Now look at the following problem on a hierarchical structure. And the way we do this is defining a procedure for constructing a deterministic fractal, and this fractal is called the Sierpinski gasket. In 2 dimensions, and there are generalizations in higher dimensions and so on. And the way it's constructed is as follows, and I'll tell you what the reason for constructing this in the first place was, and it has to do with the following fact. If you have a uniform curve, it's got at any point 2 nearest neighbors at a given distance from this point. But if the curve has a self-intersection, then at this point there are 4 such nearest neighbors. And the question was whether you could find a curve or some construction where every point has 4 nearest neighbors in this specific sense. Okay? And the idea of Sierpinski was the following. You start with an equilateral triangle. It doesn't have to be equilateral, but for simplicity, equilateral triangle. And then double it in size, and at the same time remove the middle third. So then the figure at the next stage, I'm not able to double it and draw it to scale, but at the next stage you remove this open set. Okay. Then at the next stage you do that for each of the 3 triangles that remains. So the next generation you have a figure which looks like this, in which that's missing, this is missing, and this is missing. So you have a structure with more and more holes in it of all sizes. But what we are interested in is the following. We are interested in a graph, essentially a graph of some kind. So I will focus only on the nodes of whatever remains and say that's the Sierpinski graph in 2 dimensions, and there are generalizations to higher dimensions also. So basically what's happening is you start with this simplex, this triangle, and you break it up into 3 simplexes. Remove the 4th one here, and that gets broken up into 9 of them and so on, and each time there is also a scaling up so that the figure looks bigger and bigger, or scaling down, we don't care whichever way. Now, one way of constructing the graph is as follows. It's to say I start with a triangle of some size and I decorate each bond, each edge of this triangle with a new site. So in the next stage, so in the first stage you have three sites, call them 1, 2, 3, and in the next stage you decorate the midpoints of these sites with new sites here. So now we have 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, and then in the next stage you have more sites and 15 sites and so on and so forth. It's easy to see that if you call this generation 0, generation 1, 2, 3, etc., that the number of sites goes on increasing exponentially with n. It'll go like 3 to the n essentially. So the question is, what happens if you do a random walk on this? You can blow up the size of the triangle appropriately to make sure that the size of each triangle, the smallest triangle, is always unity or something like that. Okay. So the question asked is, to go twice as far on this structure, assuming that this is one, that's one, etc., etc., how long does it take on the average? Now it doesn't matter where you put, this is a completely deterministic graph, because given the n minus 1 generation, you can find the nth generation by decorating the midpoint of each of these sites with a point and then adding all those nodes to the graph. Okay. So the question is, if you start here a random walker and there's always jumps only to nearest neighbors at any stage, how long does it take to go unit distance? Now in the original graph, the sites 2 and 3 are unit distance away, so it's clear that this walker, if he jumps at the end of every time step with equal probability to all the nearest neighbors, then these two points, if they are traps, if he reaches this or that, you've traveled unit distance. That's the end of it. So the mean time taken, T1, is equal to 1, and that's the end of it. Okay. To go to this trap or this trap. Now ask what happens in the next generation. Okay. So again you start at site 1, but you would like to go twice the distance, so you'd like to go to either 4 or 5. That's where the traps are. So the question is, it's scaled up, and now to go double the distance, how long does it take? So the assumption, the idea is to ask, you have a random walker on this graph who jumps from one site to nearest neighbor site with equal probability. If the site has two nearest neighbors, with probability half, but the generic site, apart from these sites, apart from this, this and this, you notice that every one of these sites has 4 nearest neighbors always. So the coordination number is 4 in general, except for those corner sites. Okay. So now I ask, I start here and with equal probability the walker jumps to nearest neighbor sites, what's the mean time for the walker to hit either 4 or 6? And if you hit either 4 or 6, the walk is over. Okay. Now we can do the same thing exactly as we did for the linear lattice, except that you have to now allow for the fact that it is possible that the walker will get stuck in this loop here and keep going for a long time, or go back to 1, etc., etc., and then eventually hit 6. So the question is, what is the mean time? We saw that on a linear lattice, it was to go twice as far, it was just 4 times as long, because on a lattice with j sites, you start at 0, to go to j for the first time, it took time j squared, and therefore to go to a site 2j, it'll take 4j squared, and that was it. But what is it here? Well, let's write these equations down and see what happens in this case. Now T1 is equal to, with probability half, the first jump will take you either to 2 or to 3. So it's 1/2 T2 plus 1, because you used up a time step in doing that, plus 1/2 T3 plus 1. And that's it. That's what the mean time to hit the traps from T1, starting from 1, is. Okay. But what about T2 and T3? It's clear by symmetry, since the traps are situated symmetrically, you can use a little bit of symmetry here. I don't have to write the equations for everything. T2 must be equal to T3, because the two traps here are completely symmetric. So let's call this T2. and this will imply T1 equal to T2 plus 1. Okay. What is T2 itself? What would be the recursion relation for T2? Well, where are the possible places to which from 2 you can jump to? 1, 3, 5 and 4. If you jump back to 1, you wasted a time step, but you are back to T1, right? So it is clear this is 1 quarter T1 plus the nearest neighbors are T3 plus T5 plus T4. And each time you used up a step. So this is plus 1 quarter times 4, which is 1 once again. But T3 is the same as T2. So we can kill this and write this as T2. T5 is a distinct point. We can't do anything about that. And what's T4? 0 by definition, because you're at the trap and that's it. So this is gone. And what's T5? We don't need to write a separate equation for T3 because it's the same as T2. T5 is a distinct site, and what's T5? With probability a quarter, you go T2 or T3, but these two are equal to each other. So that gives you a half times T2. I've included the T3 contribution in there. And then what about these? T4 and T6 are 0, and you go there with probability half, quarter plus quarter, right? Plus 1, that's it.
Okay. Why?
Yeah, so it's half of T2 plus 1 plus half, and the halves add up and give you a 1. So the 1 is conservation of probability. Simply saying that one time step has been used up over all the nearest neighbors, wherever you jump, right? So we have 3 equations for 3 unknowns, T1, T2 and T5. And you can solve this set of equations fairly trivially, and without any difficulty you establish that T1 is in fact 5. So on this graph, if I start at the apex A and I want to go to either the point B or C, how long will it take? Well, we saw that on this graph, if you start with the apex and you want to go to this or this, it takes you time 5 relative to 1 here in this graph. How long will it take to go from A to either B or C, the mean time? To go twice as far, it takes 5 times as long, right? This is 4 steps away, 1, 2, 3 and 4 steps away. 25. So the time unit will be 25. You have to work out the full random walk problem on this over all possible excursions of this random walker. So there are lots of loops where the walker can get stuck for a very long time, and eventually you hit either this point or that point, okay? And these are all connected, so there is no doubt that this walk will eventually hit either B or C because it is ergodic. But the mean time to do so is now going to be 25. Each time it is multiplied by 5. So what is D walk on this structure? It says T2 is 5 times T1, right? So this is log 5 over log 2, which is greater than 2. So it immediately says that R squared on this structure is like 2 over D walk, which is log 5 by log 2. And this is greater than 1, greater than 2. It immediately says that r squared goes like a power of t, which is less than 1, not 1. So the process is subdiffusive. Now you can ask, how is this an artifact of where we started? If we had not started at such a nice symmetric point, what would happen? Well, you can start here. You can start on this graph at this point, for instance, and say, what are the nearest neighbor points? That's this, 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 or this. So we can ask, how long does it take on the average to go from here to this, 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 or this? And the answer, of course, is 1. The first step you're off. Then you want to go to points twice as far from this point. In other words, you want to go either here, 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 or here. It's just scaled up twice. And the answer will turn out to be 5 once again. Okay. So I urge you to work it out on this graph, because now you have interesting points. You have this point, you have that point, and there could be lots of meanderings here without hitting these boundary points. But when you work it out, it will be exactly the same as that. You'll again discover that the walk dimension here is log 5 over log 2. Okay. By the way, what's the fractal dimension of this structure? What's d fractal going to be? Remember, when you scale things up or scale it down, break a unit interval into pieces of size epsilon by multiplied by epsilon, then it's clear that exactly as we saw in the triangular triadic Koch curve, what's happening here is that one triangle is being replaced by 1, 2, 3 triangles. And what's the size of each of these? I'm putting a point here, point here, point here, decorating. So the size is 1/2. Therefore, d fractal equal to log 3. There are, that's n of epsilon over log 2, and this is 1 over epsilon. Epsilon is 1/2. So the fractal dimension, once again, as you would expect, is between 1 and 2. It's greater than 1, less than 2, because you are on a Euclidean plane. You could play this game not with the triangles, but with simplexes. For example, tetrahedra in three-dimensional space. So in three-dimensional Euclidean space, you embed tetrahedra. So you take a tetrahedron, and at each apex, reduce the size by 1/2, and at each apex you place a tetrahedron. You get this. I don't want to draw it here. And then you get this, and so on and so forth. Okay. And now, what would be the fractal dimension of that? Pardon me? It would be, well, the fractal dimension there, if you are in d dimensions, if you are in d dimensions, it's log d plus 1 over log 2, okay? Whereas in 2 dimensions, it was log 3 over log 2, and so on. So if you are in d Euclidean dimensions, where d is greater than or equal to 2, the fractal dimension turns out to be log d plus 1 over log 2. And what would be the walk dimension? That requires a little harder work. You have to find out how many nearest neighbors there are. Here there are 2 nearest neighbors in this case. But in that graph, the more complicated graph, in a tetrahedron, you'd end up having a larger number of nearest neighbors, and you have to include those things. And it turns out that the walk dimensionality is log d plus 3 over log 2. That's why it became d log 5 here. Okay. So for the Sierpinski fractal in d Euclidean dimensions, you can write down what's the fractal dimension, you can write down what the walk dimension is, and so on. But the essential point is that in these structures with lots of nooks and crannies, it takes longer to go a given distance than it does on a regular graph. And that's why the motion is subdiffusive. You cannot describe, even though this is a Markov process, you cannot write down the usual kind of Gaussian solutions for the diffusion equation in the continuum approximation, nor is this going to be nor is this process going to lead to the conventional kind of diffusion. In the continuum limit, it's going to lead to a very peculiar subdiffusive behavior. We will talk a little bit about it when I talk about non-Markovian diffusion, okay, in terms of what are called continuous time random box. Okay. We'll come back to this. We'll come back to this graph. We'll see what is needed in order to understand a graph of this kind completely, how to work an arbitrary random walk on this kind of graph. Okay. Let me go now to a topic which I should have covered when I talked about Markov chains, but which I mentioned off and on, and that had to do with recurrence in Markov chains. When does a system come back to its starting point? In particular, we've been worried about the linear lattice, and we've been worried about random box on a lattice, and I've said things like the probability of a return to the origin is not 1 if you have a bias in the random box. It's equal to 1 when you have no bias at all. We need to establish this. I already have set the stage for it by writing this renewal equation for the first passage time density, but let's do it in the language of discrete time, discrete Markov chains, so that you have a clear understanding of where this comes from. Okay. So let's call it recurrence and first passage in Markov chains. Okay. So I have in mind a Markov chain in which the states are labeled by some integer j, okay, and the time is discrete, labeled by n, for instance. And we've been talking about the conditional probability P that you hit, for instance, a state k at time n, given that you started at the state j at time 0. We'll consider stationary Markov chains. So the origin can be shifted as you please. Okay. And time is measured in discrete units, and n is the label for time. K and j are state labels. So this is the probability that if you started at t equal to at 0 time in the state j, you are at the state k at time n by a Markov sequence of transitions, etc. Okay. So for compactness, let me write it in this form. Here. Now it's clear that if I start with j, I hit the state k to go to the state at time n, I must have hit this state k at some time in between 0 and n, either 1 or 2 or 3 for the first time. Okay. And if I hit the thing for the first time at a particular time, that's a unique event in the sense that hitting it at time 3 excludes hitting it at time 2 for the first time or time 1. Not so for p itself. But for the time I hit it the first time, that's a unique event always. So I can decompose this probability, this. I can decompose it by asking, when do I hit this state for the first time? Okay. And let's call the probability f that I hit k for the first time starting from j. So this is k 1. J, and I hit it in the first time at time 1, let's say, and after that this is multiplied by p k n minus 1 k. After that I start at 1 because it's a Markov process, it renews itself, and then in the remaining n minus 1 time units I wander around, I come back to k. This is a contribution to this probability from the event in which I start at j and hit k for the first time. But to this I must add f of k to j, p of k n minus 2 k. Right? Because these two are mutually exclusive. So what I'm doing is to decompose this in terms of mutually exclusive events based on the time of first hitting that final state, okay, plus of course dot 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 plus f of k n minus 1 j. So I hit it for the first time at time n minus 1, and after that all I have to do is to remain there k 1. And there is one more possibility, which is that I hit k for the first time at time n itself and then it is finished, right? And that exhausts all the possibilities. If you like, I can put p of k 0 k. But by definition, this is identically equal to 1, by definition. The probability that I am in k, if I start with k at time 0, is of course by definition 1, right? So I do not need this. Okay. Now this is the discrete analog of the renewal equation that I wrote down earlier, right? And now of course the obvious thing to do is to define a generating function, right? So if I define the generating function, for each of these guys. So let us define a generating function for this, for instance. This is equal to pi kj of z. That is equal to a summation from n equal to 1 to infinity p of kn j z to the power n. And similarly, let us define one for this first passage time, first passage probability, phi k j of z equal to summation n equal to 1 to infinity f of k n j z to the power n. From 1 to infinity I sum and multiply by z to the n and sum, and that is the usual way to define a generating function. Remember that the notation is such that this is the initial state and that is the final state. I have retained that same order here. So this always stands for the final state and that stands for the initial state. Yes. Then this relation here will imply the following relation, pi kj of z is equal to f kj of z, this one over here, phi kj times pi kk of z plus phi this fellow does not have a p here, so there is only an f. You are summing from 1 to infinity. Okay. Whereas in the continuum I took Laplace transforms and used the convolution theorem because time was continuous. Here time is discrete, so I just use the generating function. Okay. And that gives us an expression which says phi kj of z is equal to pi kj of z divided by 1 plus pi kk of z. Okay. A relation between the generating functions. So this means that if you solve the Markov chain equation, for instance, for this conditional probability and find its generating function, then you found the generating function for the first passage from j to k. You found the distribution itself. Okay. Now when can you assert that first passage from j to k is a sure event? Remember that these are all mutually exclusive events. Not so here, not so here at all. different ends, these are not mutually exclusive events. There will be lots of overlaps. But here, the statement that you go from J to K for the first time at time n is distinct from the statement that you go for the first time at time n prime. So the different ends are all distinct events. They are mutually exclusive. And I use that in writing this equation. Okay. So when can I assert that first passage from J to K is a sure event? I don't care when, but it's a sure event. This means the sum over all these f's over n must be equal to 1. So at some time or the other, it hits it for the first time, right? So first passage from J to K is a sure event, implies probability equal to 1 if and only if summation n equal to 1 to infinity f of k n j equal to phi k j of 1 equal to 1. So you put z equal to 1 and you have to get 1. Then it's a sure event. Otherwise, it's not a proper random variable, right? So this n is not a proper random variable. It's not normalized to unity. But if this is true, then it's a sure event. Okay. Now, in these Markov chains, in which every system, every state is connected to every other system, and there are no traps or cyclic subsystems and so on, it'll always happen that you wait long enough, you sum over all n, it'll definitely hit it. Okay. So we'll come back to that. But now let's ask, what happens for recurrence? I want to start with an initial state and I want to say, do I ever come back to this state or not? So recurrence would imply that this k is equal to j. So recurrence of the state j, recurrence of the distribution now, the moment generating function is phi jj of z. This is equal to a summation n equal to 1 to infinity f of jn j. And this should be unity if you put z equal to 1, because this itself is z to the power n here. And we know that phi jj of z equal to pi jj of z divided by 1 plus pi jj of z. These are all probabilities. You have summed over probabilities multiplied by z to the n. So if z is x, which is a positive number, for instance, these guys are all positive numbers. And this clearly looks like a fraction here. But if its recurrence is a sure event, phi jj of 1 must be equal to 1. So this means recurrence of j is a sure event if and only if, how can this fellow be equal to 1? Only if pi jj of 1 tends to infinity, if it diverges. That's the only possibility. If and only if limit z tends to 1, pi jj of z tends to infinity. It should diverge. In other words, summation n equal to 1 to infinity p jn j should tend to infinity. Only then will it happen. Okay. Let's check this out. Let's put, let's say, let the Markov chain be a random walk on a linear lattice. It's a completely translation invariant process, infinitely near lattice. So we can call any site the site J. We'll call it the origin. Okay. So let's look at return to the origin in a, on a linear lattice. So we have all these sites, etc. This is the origin. This is minus 1, 1, minus 2, 2, and so on. And let's look at a biased walk, the more general case. So the probability of a jump to the right is alpha, and the probability of a jump to the left is beta, where alpha plus beta is 1. Okay? Yeah.
F is the first time probability. Also.
This is the first, yes.
So, J, starting with J should be 1, isn't it?
Starting with J at t equal to 0, the question is, when do I come back to J for the first time? Now, if I remain at that point, then at time 1, I am still there. So, that's F1, n equal to 1.
Yes. We are not considering n equal to 0.
N equal to 0 is a starting point. So, n runs 0, 1, 2, 3, etc. Okay? So, I start at an origin. At the end of every second, I jump. Now, at the end of 1 second, I may not have jumped. In that case, I am still there, and that contributes, that would correspond to FJ1J. Okay? Now, if I want to look at 2, J2, and I come back, I go out in the first step and come back in the second step. So that would be JN equal to 2. It's clear that on this lattice, when I look at the lattice case, it's clear that I can come back to 0 only on an even step. I cannot come back on an odd step. So that should emerge, that F would not contribute at all. F would be 0 if N is 3 and J is 0. It would not be able to come back in 3 steps. It either comes back in 2 steps or 4 steps or 6 steps and so on and so forth. Okay. So notice that it's a good point. Notice I'm summing from 1 to infinity, because that's the meaning of recurrence. I have to let time go on. Okay. Similarly for P, I've kept it from 1 to infinity, and we'll see the significance of that. Okay. So we need to see if this is true and under what conditions it's true. If it's finite, if this series is finite, then it's clear that in this ratio, this is a finite number, this is a finite number, and this is not equal to 1 if you set z equal to 1. Okay. On the other hand, if it diverges, we can be sure that it's going to be a recurrent event. Okay. So all we need to do is to compute this number and ask what it is. So let's look at what pi jj is for the linear, for the biased random walk. Pi 0, 0, without loss of generality, I take j equal to 0 here, any site at all, of z. This is equal to what? It's equal to a summation n equal to 1 to infinity p of 0 n 0. It's the probability that at time step n, I'm at the origin, having started from the origin at time 0, right? So this is equal to a summation n equal to 1 to infinity, n binomial symbol n, and then you had n minus j over 2 to go to site j, if you're going to end up at site j, but that's going to be site 0, so it's n over 2 on this side, and then you have alpha to the power n plus j over 2 and beta to the power n minus j over 2 to hit the site j at time n, but we want to hit the site 0 once again. So this is equal to alpha beta to the n over 2. Moreover, this probability, this combinatorial thing, the binomial distribution, is true only if the point j, starting from the origin, the point j has the same parity as n. So n minus j must be even. So what are the conditions for, if you had p j n and you wrote n plus j over 2, alpha to the n plus j over 2, beta to the n minus j over 2, the statement is that mod j less than equal to n, because you can't go beyond that in n steps, and n minus j even. But if you set j equal to 0, it only says n is greater than or equal to 0, which we know, and n is even here, and that's the answer there. But this summation runs from 1 to infinity. This thing runs from 1 to infinity, right? So what does it, there's also a z to the power whatever. So z to the power n equal to this. And n must be even. So let's put, let n equal to 2k. And k runs from 1, 2, 3, etc. Because n runs here from 2, 3, 2, 4, 6, etc. So it says pi 0, 0 of z equal to summation k equal to 1 to infinity 2k, and then there's a k here. Now let's put pi 0, 0 of 1 to see what happens. Alpha beta to the power k. And that's all. We have to sum this series and find out when it converges and if it and when it diverges, right? Well, how would you do that? Well, a simple way to do that is to write down what these factorials are. So what does 2k k alpha beta to the power k, what does this fellow do? Well, it's clear that this is equal to 2k factorial here over k factorial squared, and then there's an alpha beta to the power k, and we need to know what the large k behavior of this coefficient is and then do a ratio test or something like that, right? For the large k you do Stirling, so this goes to 2k to the power 2k, so let's write it as 2 to the 2k k to the power 2k e to the minus 2k, and then square root of 2 pi times whatever it is, so square root of 4 pi k, that's Stirling used there, and in the denominator you have k to the k e to the minus k square root of 2 pi k squared, so there are two of them. And then there's an alpha beta to the power k, and as you can see k to the 2k cancels, e to the minus 2k cancels, you have a 1 over square root of k from these two, and then you have a 2 to the 2k, by combine it here it's 4 alpha beta to the k, right? So this coefficient, so the term, the any typical term goes like, the k term for example goes like 4 alpha beta to the k over square root of k. This is what the kth term goes like finally. And I do a ratio test, take the n plus 1 to the nth term, and then of course square root of k plus k over k plus 1 tends to 1, so the power of k doesn't do anything and you're left with just 4 alpha beta, right? So it says convergent if 4 alpha beta is less than 1, and divergent, certainly divergent equal to 1. Okay. Divergent because this will go away. And then you just have a 1 over square root of k, which if you sum over k becomes infinite, right? It will diverge like the square root of the cutoff. Now what's the largest value that 4 alpha beta can have? 1, because beta is 1 minus alpha. So the largest value it can have is 1. So this will imply alpha equal to beta equal to half. Unbiased. So if it's unbiased, you're guaranteed that the return to the origin is guaranteed. That's it. But if it's biased either to the right or left, if alpha is bigger than beta or less than beta, it doesn't matter. 4 alpha beta is less than 1, and then the series converges, so the probability of a return to the origin is less than 1. We should like to find out what exactly it is. We'd like to find out, you know, in that case, what is it, etc., which we'll do in a minute. So let's see. So let's do the following. Let's first look at this case where the return to the origin is not probable with probability 1, but probability less than 1. Find out exactly what this probability is. And then we'll come to the case where we have a return to the origin which is sure, namely with probability 1, and try to find out what's the mean time that it takes to do so. So let's first consider 4 alpha beta less than 1. It says if 4 alpha beta less than 1, i.e. the walk is biased, then we still need to know what is pi naught naught of z. Pi naught naught of 1 rather, of 1. This is equal to this guy, 2kk alpha beta to the k. Summation k equal to 1 to infinity. Does anyone remember what this series is? What it is? Okay. It's a binomial series. We can play around with this, but it's a binomial series. I'll just write the answer down. This turns out to be equal to 1 over square root of 1 minus 4 alpha beta. Okay. There are several ways of doing this. You can remember it in many, many different ways. It's useful to remember what the general binomial theorem is in a form which is easy to apply to these series, because what happens when you have negative index, negative non-integer index, etc., is that a lot of minus signs cancel out, etc. But the way I remember it is slightly different than this. What one way to remember it is like this. Write this as summation, consider k equal to 0 to infinity. By the way, the k equal to 0 term has been left out here, so this is this minus 1. Okay. But let me show you how this is remembered, how I remember it. So if you have 2k, k, and then something, let's call it xi to the power k, if you had a thing like this, then this is equal to a summation k equal to 0 to infinity, 2k factorial, that's gamma of 2k plus 1. So this is gamma of 2k plus 1 over gamma of k plus 1, that's k factorial, another k factorial, and then xi to the k. So let's write this xi to the k over k separately, factorial separately, this fashion. And now I remember what's called the duplication formula for the gamma function. Gamma of 2z can be written as gamma of z times gamma of z plus half, okay, times a 2 to the power 2z minus 1, which is 2 to the 2k, over gamma of half, which is root pi, gamma of k plus half, gamma of k plus 1, over gamma of k plus 1, xi to the k over k factorial, and this factor cancels out. So you have 2 to the 2k, so that becomes 4 xi to the k. That's right. So it's 4 xi to the k, and then there's a gamma of k k plus half over gamma of half. And this is a binomial series. It's a binomial series for 1 minus 4 xi to the power minus a half. So if you had an alpha here, some constant alpha, it's 1 minus this whatever is the argument to the power minus alpha. Okay. So that's an easy way to remember the binomial series. And if you apply that here, it's 1, I put a 4 here and then 1 minus, because there's a 2k here, it gave me a half. It's 1 over square root here minus 1. So that's pi naught naught of 1. Therefore, we know what phi naught naught of 1 is. So it says phi 0 0 of 1 equal to pi 0 0 of 1 over 1 plus pi 0 0 of 1. This is equal to 1 minus the square root divided by the square root, and it cancels out. So this is equal to 1 minus square root of 1 minus. Right. Okay. But what's this fellow? We can simplify it. 1 minus 4 alpha beta equal to 1 minus 4 alpha times 1 minus alpha. So it's plus 4 alpha squared equal to 2 alpha plus 1 minus 1 the whole squared. So this is equal to 1 minus the square root of 2 alpha minus 1 squared. What's that? Mod 2 alpha minus 1 mod. Which is 1 minus mod alpha minus beta. That's a useful way to remember it. So if you got a bias and alpha is not equal to beta, then the total probability of a return to the origin is this number, summed over all walks. Okay? And that's a number between 0 and 1. But if alpha is equal to beta, the probability is 1. So this right away tells us that summing over all possible walks, if you have a bias in either direction, because you've got an infinite lattice in both sides, the system has less than 1 probability of returning, depending on how biased it is. Okay. Of course, as you can see, if either alpha or beta is 0, so that it's in unidirectional motion, you're never going to come back. The probability is 0 directly. Okay. Now the question is, when it does return, when alpha is equal to beta, equal to half, what then is the actual distribution of this return time? Okay. Now what we have to do is to compute this number. So if alpha equal to beta equal to half, recurrence or return to the origin is a sure event. But we need to find out what's the distribution of the time. As I said, you can return to the origin only on an even time step. So it's clear that the probability distribution will have support only when n equal to 2, 4, 6, etc. Okay. So let's see what this probability distribution actually is. Now we need to compute these numbers. So let's compute pi 0, 0 of 1. This is equal to summation k equal to 1 to infinity. Again, 2k and a k that's this alpha equal to beta equal to 1 equal to half in this case. So there was a 1/4 here, and inside you also had a z to the power n, but I put n equal to 2k. So this says z squared over 4 to the power k. And by the rule which we just had, this is equal to 1 over square root of 1 minus 4 times this guy, which is z squared, minus 1, because I had left out the k equal to 0 term here. So that gives us an explicit formula here in this case. It says phi 0, 0 of z equal to 1 minus square root of 1 minus z squared divided by the square root, and the whole thing divided by 1 plus this guy, which cancels the square root. Therefore, that's it. That's it. If you now expand this in powers of n, z, in powers of z, it will give you the coefficients, will give you the first passage, first recurrence time probabilities at those n's. Okay. So, the coefficient of z to the n will give f 0 n 0. Will give you the distribution of this time n. Okay. Of course, n equal to 0 is not a recurrence. So that term cancels out, as you can see. If you put z equal to 0, the 1 cancels out. Okay. And let us do this as a power series and see what happens. So this thing here is equal to 1 minus, and then 1 minus z squared to the power half. So 1 minus z squared over 2. The next term is plus half into half minus 1, which is minus half, z squared whole squared, that is z power 4 over 2 factorial minus dot 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 dot, etc. So you will see that all the terms will remain positive. The next one will have half into minus half into half minus 2 and so on and so forth, minus 3 halves, etc. But it will appear with a minus sign. So it will again give you a positive contribution. This will tell you, for instance, that P 0 2 0 equal to the coefficient of z squared, which is a half. P 0 4 0 equal to, we can compute what this number is, it is going to be 1/8, these two 1/8, etc. So you can compute what the probability of return is at the end of every even time step, and all the odd time steps there is no return to the origin. And you can check that it is normalized to unity. I do not have to check it independently. All I have to do is to put z equal to 1 and show that the answer is 1, and then the probability is summed automatically. So it is clear that it is normalized to unity in this case. What is the mean time it takes to do this? What is the mean time it takes to do? It is the derivative of this at z equal to 1. Right? So the mean time t to go from 0 to 0 to recur to 0 averaged over all over this distribution must be equal to d over dz phi 0 0 of z at z equal to 1. And what is that equal to? It is infinity, because if I differentiate this, I get a 1 over square root 1 minus z squared, and I put z equal to 1, it is gone, right. So this is equal to infinity. Okay. So that checks out. We knew that this process is null recurrent. It is recurrent, but it is null recurrent in the sense that the mean time to have for it to happen is infinite. The first moment diverges, but it does happen with probability 1. We could also ask, as time increases, how will this diverge? How will this mean time diverge? Remember that in the continuum case, we discovered that the first passage time from any point to any other point went like 1 over t to the 3 halves for the diffusion equation. And I multiplied by t, I ended up with a thing like integral dt over t to the half. So over a long time, if I integrate, this guy here goes like t to the power half, and it diverges in this fashion, right? So the question is, what is that going to do? Is there a similar thing? Is there a 1 over n to the 3 halves or whatever? Where does this come from? If so, where does that come from? The answer is very straightforward. All we have to do is to look at what the general coefficient here does. After all, it came from the expansion of this function here. Now, we work this backwards in the other direction, and then you discover I use this identity here, but now I got 1 minus z squared to the power plus a half. So it's clear that this must come from summing k equal to 0 to infinity, 2k, k, this guy here in this fashion, or in terms of the gamma functions, gamma of, I have a plus half here, so this must have been a gamma k minus half over gamma of minus half, which is minus 2 root pi, so that's irrelevant here, some constant. And then there was also a gamma of k plus 1 here. This is what the coefficient looked like, right? Times the z squared or whatever it is sitting here. Now, what does this fellow look like for large k? What does this look like? From Stirling, what is this going to do? Gamma of k plus a divided by gamma of k plus b. Or z plus a, z plus b. What does this look like when mod z becomes very large? You have to use Stirling once again. Remember, this will go like z plus a to the power z plus a. This will go like z plus b to the power z plus b. And if a and b are finite and z is large, this has z to the power a on top and z to the power b below. So it's clear that this is going to go like mod z to the power a minus b. So what is this ratio going to do? It's k to the power minus half k minus 1. So it's going like 1 over k to the 3 halves. That's precisely your 1 over t to the 3 halves behavior in the continuum. K is like time. 2k was n, as you can see. And now you're going to multiply this by a k and sum, you're going to get coefficients which go like 1 over square root of k. And when you integrate that, you're going to get the cutoff to the power plus half on top. It will diverge. So it's the same divergence, exactly the same power law divergence as we had in the continuum case. Okay? But this is an exact solution. This tells you exactly when it converges and when it doesn't. Okay? Now, I made the statement, so to summarize, in one dimension on a linear lattice, if you have a biased random walk, a constant bias, either to the right or to the left, then a return to any particular point is not a sure event. It's an event which happens with probability less than 1, no matter how long you wait. On the other hand, if there's no bias in the walk, then a return to any point is a sure event, as is first passage to any point, from any point, is a sure event, but the mean time for it is infinite. Such a process is said to be recurrent, but null recurrent, when the mean time is infinite. Okay. Now you can ask what happens in higher dimensions, what happens in 2, 3, 4, etc., etc., and the answer is known. And I'll do this next time because we need a little bit of information about the Green function. It'll turn out that in dimensions 1 and 2, first passage in the case of unbiased walks, first passage from any point to any other point is a sure event. But the mean time is infinite. In dimensions greater than 2, 3, 4, etc., etc., it's not a sure event, and the total probability of return to any point is less than 1, okay? Or first passage to any point is less than 1, even if there's no bias in the walk. And we can establish this directly. It's not very difficult to do so, so we'll do that next time. Okay? But again, notice that the Markov property has been used very clearly, because without that, then all these statements go out of the window and you need to re-examine the case over again. But because of that renewal equation, we were able to make this very powerful statement. Now, I might mention, you could ask, what happens on that Sierpinski graph if I now go to an infinite generation? I generate this so that the number of points increases exponentially. What happens on such a graph? Well, if it's a finite graph, it's ergodic in the sense that every point is visited infinitely often. Unless you have traps, then of course it ends. But if you don't have traps and if you have an infinite graph, then is it guaranteed that if you start at any one point, you hit all the other points, any arbitrary point? This has to do again with the dimensionality being less than 2 or greater than 2, but it is not the walk dimension or the fractal dimension, but a certain ratio of these two, which is called the spectral dimension, and that has to be less than or equal to 2 for the walk to be recurrent, otherwise it's transient. I'll state what that dimensionality is next time.